I want to look with you this morning. We're going to take a little diversion and we'll pick up again on the eight laws of health soon, God willing. But this morning, I'd like to take a look with you about this man and to understand where he came from, his impact upon society, his impact upon Seventh-day Adventism, and then tragically, his ultimate demise. So before we do that, though, let's kneel for prayer. Father in heaven, we're grateful today for your promises. We are grateful that you will abide with us. We are grateful for the promise that tumbles 20 centuries to us today, that Jesus gave to the disciples in the upper room to strengthen them as they faced a dark world back 20 centuries ago, when Jesus said, "I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you." Father, we claim that promise this morning for the power of the Holy Spirit to give us discernment, to give us humility, to soften our hearts, to allow you to be the Lord of all we do. Bless us and strengthen us to that end as we study about this man of old. In Jesus' name, amen. John Kellogg, John Harvey Kellogg, was arguably the most famous physician of the late 19th and early 20th centuries. He advocated the concept of eating clean foods, exercise, and other healthful innovations. You know, I noticed in studying about John Harvey Kellogg that as John Harvey Kellogg, what made him great in his heyday was he went along with the eight natural laws of health that you readily find in the Bible and in the writings of Ellen White. That's what made him great. And folk, he was truly the most famous physician of the late 19th and 20th centuries. Many of the vegetarian foods that Kellogg developed and offered his patients were publicly marketed. He's best known today for the invention of the breakfast cereal cornflakes. You know, you go into a store and on the shelf you've got Kellogg's cornflakes. John Harvey Kellogg was the man who originated those and many other health food products. Now, of course, Will Keith Kellogg, John Harvey's younger brother, was the one who ultimately took over the company of Kellogg's. Tragically, they went to and had many lawsuits against each other. And it's a tragic story, but we're not going to get into that this morning. His creation of the modern breakfast cereal changed the American breakfast landscape forever. Kellogg originated eating cereal at breakfast. He's the one who started the whole thing. He had many notable patients that came to the Battle Creek Sanitarium. William Howard Taft, President of the United States. Composer and pianist Percy Grainger. Arctic explorers Stephenson and Raoul Amundsen. World travelers Richard Halliburton, aviator Amelia Earhart, economist Irving Fisher, Nobel Prize winning playwright George Bernard Shaw, actor and athlete Johnny Weissmuller, founder of the Ford Motor Company, Henry Ford. Thomas Edison, the famous inventor, African-American activist, Sojourner Truth, and actress Sarah Bernhardt. Folks, that's a who's who of famous Americans in the late 19th and early 20th century. These are famous people. What were they doing at Battle Creek? John Kellogg was espousing the eight laws of health in Battle Creek. And because of that, people would go there to get well. They went there to get well. In 1896, and here's a picture of John Harvey Kellogg, he introduced something called NuTos, the first commercially produced alternative to meat. So you look at vegetarian meats today, your veggie dogs, your veggie burgers. John Kellogg was the originator of that. Folks, for anyone to look at this man's life and not say that he was not a brilliant man, they'd be wrong. John Kellogg was brilliant. Tragically, he realized that. And that's what destroyed him. NuTos was made primarily from peanuts and resembled cold roast mutton. Vegetarian, of course. By seasoning or marinating, NuTos could be made to taste like fried chicken or barbecue. Served with mashed potatoes and vegetables, it could mimic a traditional American meal. John Kellogg was a brilliant man. Ellen White, commenting about John Harvey Kellogg. Actually, Ellen White and her husband James in the 1870s financed John Harvey Kellogg to go to medical school. The Whites had a very close relationship with John Harvey Kellogg. It's fascinating as you study these different famous Seventh-day Adventists, E.J. Wagoner, Alonzo T. Jones, John Kellogg, D.M. Canwright, George Butler, Uriah Smith. Folk, they were all very, very close to James and Ellen White. In fact, later on, we will read a quote where Ellen White, when she was overwhelmed with consternation over the path that John Harvey Kellogg was going, she wrote a letter to him and she said, "I write to you as I would write to my own son." In the beginning, this is from the General Conference Bulletin 1903, pages 86 and 87. It says, Ellen White had had a long and close relationship with John Kellogg ever since he completed his medical training in 1876. And began teaching in the early days of the Health Institute. He had been a pillar of strength and influence as the medical work expanded. She had written him thousands of pages of letters and counsel and guidance. She had watched with a mother's love and interest his success in developing the medical work. Frequently, she defended him against opposition and criticism of those less talented than he. She said, "Many souls have been converted. Many wonderful cures have been wrought. The Lord stood by the side of Dr. Kellogg as he performed difficult operations. When the doctor was overwrought by taxing labor, God understood the situation. He put his hand on Dr. Kellogg's hand as he operated. And through his power, the operations were successful. I wish this to be understood. God has given Dr. Kellogg the success that he has had. I've tried constantly to keep this before him, telling him it was God who was working with him, and that the truth of God was to be magnified by his physician. God does not endorse the efforts put forth by different ones to make the work of Dr. Kellogg as hard as possible. in order to build themselves up. God gave the light on health reform, and those who rejected it rejected God. One and another who knew better said that it all came from Dr. Kellogg, and they made war upon him. Dr. Kellogg's success was totally dependent upon his realization that he was nothing without the power of God. And folk, that goes with any and every human being. If anybody is doing the work of God and somehow they go above that, they are destined to fall. They're destined to be destroyed. So God was with Kellogg in the beginning as he opened up the sanitarium in Battle Creek, Michigan. Further, Ellen White, Manuscript 70, page in 1905, she said, "There's no question that Dr. Kellogg was an unselfish, dedicated, much-loved man. He was a generous, great man, but it was largely, yet not altogether, through John Harvey Kellogg that the great adversary introduced into the ranks of Seventh-day Adventists the seeds of error in the form of so-called new light, just at a time when the medical work was at its height." Now, pantheism is the term used to designate the strange new teachings that were being introduced. Pantheism pictures God not as a great personal being, but as a mysterious essence, an impersonal influence pervading all nature. God is seen in all nature, in the trees, the flowers, the sunshine, the air, and human beings. The power of God in nature is confused with the personality of God. So John Harvey Kellogg started off wonderfully as long as he was in submission to the authority of God and the spirit of prophecy. But over time, Kellogg began to play around with this idea of pantheism. In this manuscript, Ellen White says Dr. Kellogg had toyed with these concepts before James White's death in 1881, and considering it great light, had discussed it with Ellen White. "Those theories are wrong," she told him. "I have met them before." He seemed dazed as she showed him the outcome of espousing such a philosophy. She then admonished, "Never teach such theories in our institutions. Do not present them to the people." So Ellen White, way back, before James White's death in 1881, John Harvey Kellogg had begun to play with this idea of pantheism. And Ellen White warned him, "Do not teach this in our institutions. Do not present them to the people." Beauty about the writings of Ellen White: nobody misunderstood where she was standing. She made it crystal clear. You will be successful as long as you follow in the path the Lord has laid out in his word and in the 8 laws of health. Stay away from pantheism. Stay away from depending upon yourself. Somewhere along the way, just like with 2 contemporaries of his, A.T. Jones and E.J. Wagoner, John Harvey Kellogg's work in the medical field, it was headed straight to the stars. Battle Creek Sanitarium was treating some of the most famous of people. But like Jones and Wagner, Kellogg made shipwreck of his faith. He began advocating false theories, spreading terrible rumors about Ellen White, and eventually renounced the faith that he once loved. The best laid plans of mice and men. What might have been? What might have been? Folk, there's something, and it's within all of us. It's within all of us. We get some ideas, and we begin to have success. And then we begin to think, I can do this myself. I can sidestep submission to the power of God and to His principles, and I can do it my way. And folk, tragically, a man blessed of God, A.T. Jones, another man, these two men through whom Ellen White said the Holy Spirit gave them a most precious message, they got too big in their own minds, and it killed them, destroyed them. The same thing happened to John Harvey Kellogg. At the time when Ford and Edison and Taft and Earhart and Sojourner Truth and these famous people were coming to Battle Creek, through the right arm of the message, God was opening doors for people to hear about Christ and His power to save from sin. God was using the right arm of the message to influence these famous people to hear the three angels' messages. And it was then in the late 1890s that John Harvey Kellogg started to go down. Actually, it began a few years before that. John Harvey Kellogg started on a slippery slope. And it started very clearly by 1895. It was at that time that John Harvey Kellogg had established the American Medical Missionary College right there in Battle Creek. And he had begun to divorce it from the denominational church at that time. In the charter for that school, John Kellogg had written, "This is not a sectarian school, and sectarian doctrines would not be taught there." That's from a magazine called Medical Missionary, October of 1895. Sectarian doctrines. What John Kellogg said was, "We're starting a school in Battle Creek, Michigan, that's connected to the Battle Creek Sanitarium that will be funded by Seventh-day Adventists. But we won't teach Adventist beliefs in Battle Creek at this school. We're not going to do that." Why? John Harvey Kellogg, folk, had entered onto a course where it was no longer about the Advent message. It was no longer about crying out to a world lost in sin, pointing people to Christ and to His law and to His truth. No, folk, now it was becoming John Harvey Kellogg wanted power. John Harvey Kellogg wanted influence. John Harvey Kellogg wanted people to look to him and not to Christ and His truth. Kellogg declared at this time when the three angels were sounding, Jones had just spoken before Congress a few years before. Foreign missions were advancing throughout the world. Ellen White had declared of him, there are times when the truth must be spoken, whether men will hear or whether they will forbear. This is written from Australia, June 6th of 1898. She wrote this, the Lord is greatly dishonored when those who claim to believe the truth fail to harmonize among themselves and make their appeals to lawyers. Will you study the Word of God? Heed its instruction on this point. The interests of the cause of God are not to be committed to men who have no connection with heaven. See, John Harvey Kellogg was linking up with lawyers to divorce the school from conference control. That's what he did. And he used the lawyers to create a format whereby at any time Kellogg could take the school into his own hands. That's what Ellen White is referring to here. And she says that at this time, John Harvey Kellogg had no connection with heaven. Matters have been presented before me that have filled my soul with keen anguish. I saw men linking up arm in arm with lawyers, but God was not in their company. Having many ideas regarding the work, they go to the lawyers for help to carry out their plans. See, it was no longer God's plans that Kellogg was promoting. Now it was his plans. And folk, that line can become so muddled and so confusing so quickly. When we want so badly to advance the cause of God that we can use means to do that are not in God's plan, but we can say, oh, that's the Lord's leading, that's His direction. And that's what John Kellogg was doing in the late 1890s. John Kellogg was convinced that it was God's plan that he gain control of that school in Battle Creek. They go to lawyers for help to carry out their plans. I am commissioned to say to such that you are not moving under the inspiration of the Spirit of God. It's a fine line, folks. It's a very fine line. John Harvey Kellogg had crossed it. He had crossed it. Not only did Kellogg seek to separate the medical work from the church, but he also wanted to tie all Adventist sanitariums to Battle Creek. Since Kellogg controlled Battle Creek, he hoped to take all the medical work with him. Now, folk, here again, there'd been a time when the work was about glorifying God. But now it was about saving John Harvey Kellogg and his reputation. Since Kellogg, okay, this was by 1900. Ellen White is still in Australia. And letter 3, 1900, Ellen White wrote this. She said, the money that flowed so freely into Dr. Kellogg's hands from the gifts of the Wessels family, should not $1 of it have gone in that line. Now, just for a little background, there was a very wealthy South African family, the Wessel family. They were a part of the diamond mine discoveries in the late 1890s. And the Wessels, one of the Wessels, his name was Peter. Fantastic story. But Peter Wessels became a Seventh-day Adventist Christian in South Africa. And in response to his love for the truth, he sent quite a bit of money to the conference church in Battle Creek. Well, the money fell into the hands of John Harvey Kellogg. And so Ellen White says he should have been so thoroughly, unselfishly awake to the broad vineyard to be worked that he would not have lost his judgment and centered the money he has done in Chicago missions. Kellogg had a mission in Chicago where he helped drunks. It was a worthy work. But Kellogg poured all the money that came from the Wessels into his mission in Chicago. Ellen White was crying out because, as she said, he should have awakened to the broad vineyard to be worked. Folk, there were needs in Australia. There were needs in Africa. There were needs in Europe. There were needs in America. But John Harvey Kellogg had become so centered on me and the advancement of me and the glorification of me that when that money came in, Kellogg influenced that money going into Chicago missions, not into the work at large. She goes on and says, God did not inspire him to do this work. Our missionaries in Africa have hurt their record and influence. For in their great state, they used advantages of food in their hands, requiring a price that was too much. And then Ellen White wrote this. She said to the president at that time, George Irwin, she said, save Dr. Kellogg from himself. He is not heeding the counsel he should heed. So folk, John Harvey Kellogg is messing with the Adventist institutions in Battle Creek. He is misappropriating monies because it's no longer about the work of God. Now it's about the work of John Harvey Kellogg. Ellen White wrote, it's quoted in 8 Testimonies, pages 190 and 191. She said this, I write to you as a mother would write to her son. I would help you if I could. I would go to see you if I could feel it my duty to leave the work here in Australia. But I dare not do this. You have built up hopes and nurtured plans without due consideration of how the tower is to be completed. As one who knows, as one who has been permitted to see the results of the work that you have taken upon you, I call upon you to stop and consider. God knows your frame. He knows you are but dust. You will certainly need the counsel, not only of those who have encouraged you to go on in the work which you deem so important, but the counsel of men who at the present time are able to see more clearly than you do the results that will follow certain undertakings. Cast not behind you as of no consequence the warnings that as yet you do not understand. If you receive the messages of warning sent to you, you will be saved from great trial. Ellen White wrote that to John Kellogg while she was still in Australia, warning him to turn around, to make God and his truth the focus, and not the aggrandizement and the exaltation of Kellogg. But tragically, John Kellogg could not see clearly anymore. Now John Harvey Kellogg was on a path where he was rejecting the counsel of Ellen White. He was seeking for wealth for himself and control in Battle Creek. And in so doing, John Harvey Kellogg could still declare, God is still with me. God is still leading me in spite of the fact that he was rejecting the spirit of prophecy and seeking his own exaltation at the same moment. Tragically, folk, but how easily the devil can play with our mind, as he did with Kellogg's, to think that Kellogg was still doing God's work when Kellogg was seeking to destroy it. Well, 1902, the Battle Creek Sanitarium burned to the ground. February of 1902. This was huge in the history of John Harvey Kellogg. While the basic health principles being applied at Battle Creek Sanitarium were still solid, the Lord was not blessing the efforts of Kellogg because he was seeking to tear away the control of the sanitarium from the church. Nor could the Lord bless the continual plans for larger and larger additions to the sanitarium. The Lord had wanted multiple sanitariums in many places, not just one in Battle Creek. You see, folk, when Battle Creek burned to the ground in 1902, Ellen White begged the brethren. She said, God burned that to the ground so that the sanitarium would not be rebuilt in Battle Creek. Ellen White said, we want sanitariums scattered everywhere. Folk, Battle Creek was an Adventist colony. There were so many Seventh-day Adventists in Battle Creek. And Ellen White said, we must scatter the message. Sanitariums are to be built everywhere on a much smaller scale. And while Ellen White was saying that, John Harvey Kellogg had already laid out plans for a huge sanitarium in Battle Creek. It was about control. It was about power. It was about dominance. Ellen White in Eighth Testimonies, page 232, she said this, the leaders in our medical work at Battle Creek have endeavored to bind our medical institutions fast in accordance with their plans. Notwithstanding the many warnings given them that this should not be done, they have desired to bind up these institutions in some way, so that all our medical work shall be under their control. In the past, I have written much upon this subject. I must now repeat the admonitions given. The Lord forbids that every sanitarium and bathhouse established should be brought under one control, bound up with the medical institution at Battle Creek. The managers at Battle Creek have their hands full now. They should devote their strength to the work of making this sanitarium what it should be. One man is not to think that he can be conscience for all the medical workers. Human beings are to look to the Lord God of heaven alone for wisdom and guidance. In establishing and developing medical institutions, our brethren must not be asked to work in accordance with the plans of a kingly ruling power. A change must be brought about. The plan to fasten every medical institution to the central organization at Battle Creek must be relinquished. This plan, God forbids. And while Ellen White was writing that, We will see another statement momentarily where John Harvey Kellogg, clearly out of the Lord's will, was encouraging young men and women at Battle Creek to write letters to their families and to friends and say, God is doing wonderful things in Battle Creek. Everybody should come to Battle Creek. So, while John Harvey Kellogg was trying to strangle the Adventist health work and trying to monopolize funding into Battle Creek and into his Chicago mission, all the while he claimed to be doing the work of God. Paul? Absolutely, Paul.
They made that comment. It's on record.
Absolutely. Paul's comment for the camera is that right around the time of the burning at the Battle Creek Sanitarium, the Review and Herald, which was also in Battle Creek, also burned to the ground. And the Battle Creek Fire Department said exactly what Paul said. They said, we shouldn't even go, because as we would douse the fire with water, it was as though we were pouring gasoline on it.
So this kingly power that we're seeing in our denomination and in these presidential churches was being practiced from the beginning.
Absolutely, Samuel. Samuel's comment was, the kingly power that we see today in Adventism, both denominationally and in self-supporting work, Samuel, it's been going on for a long time. A long time. It's just, and the kingly power that Ellen White was condemning from Battle Creek was on the shoulders of one man, John Harvey Kellogg. Kellogg wanted to, well, as you noticed here, in this statement, Ellen White was warning the brethren, do not tie all of the Adventist medical institutions to Battle Creek. That's what Kellogg wanted, so that he could have complete control. It was about control. It was about power. It was about dominance. Tragedy. And all the while that he was doing this, Kellogg was telling the Adventist young people, come to Battle Creek because God is doing wonderful things. God wasn't there. Another statement, 8 Testimonies, page 227, as I consider the state of things in Battle Creek, I tremble for our youth who go there. The light given me by the Lord, our youth should not collect in Battle Creek to receive their education. The fact that the sanitarium has been rebuilt does not change the light. That which in the past has made Battle Creek a place unsuitable for the education of our youth makes it unsuitable today so far as influence is concerned. When the call came to move out of Battle Creek, the plea was, we're here, we're all settled. It would be an impossibility to move without enormous expense. The Lord permitted fire to consume the principal buildings of the Review and Herald and the sanitarium, and thus remove the greatest objection urged against moving out of Battle Creek. It was His design that instead of rebuilding the one large sanitarium, our people should make plants in several places. These smaller sanitariums should have been established where land could be secured for agricultural purposes. It's God's plan that agriculture shall be connected with the work of our sanitariums and schools. Our youth need the education to be gained from this line of work. It is well, more than well, essential that efforts be made to carry out the Lord's plan in this respect. While Ellen White was writing all of this, the brethren in Battle Creek with John Harvey Kellogg were already making plans. And for those who were not astute, John Harvey Kellogg was making the sanitarium a monster, making it so much bigger than what the plans had originally stated, which he had promised to the brethren. Folks, the sanitarium became an absolute nightmare because the denomination could not afford the expenses. Absolute nightmare. Eight Testimonies, page 97. Ellen White said, "Today I received a letter from Elder Daniels regarding the destruction of the review office by fire. I feel very sad as I consider the great loss to the cause. I know that this must be a very trying time for the brethren in charge of the work and for the employees of the office. I am afflicted with all who are afflicted, but I was not surprised by the sad news. For in the visions of the night I have seen an angel standing with a sword as of fire stretched over Battle Creek. Once in the daytime while my pen was in my hand, I lost consciousness. It seemed as if this sword of flame were turning first in one direction and then in another. Disaster seemed to follow disaster, because God was dishonored by the devising of men to exalt and glorify themselves." So how would they finance this monster called the renovated Battle Creek Sanitarium? Well, the General Conference president at that time, his name was A.G. Daniels. A.G. Daniels had watched as Ellen White's book, Christ Object Lessons, had been spread around and was being sold for missionary purposes. Well, A.G. Daniels looked at John Harvey Kellogg, a powerful doctor, and a very popular health lecturer, and A.G. Daniels said, "John Harvey, why don't you write a book? And we will use the monies from that book to fund the Battle Creek Sanitarium." John Harvey Kellogg said, "Fine, A.G., I'll do it." And in 1903, about a year after the fire, John Harvey Kellogg came out with his now infamous book called The Living Temple. And in the book, The Living Temple, was contained what Ellen White called the alpha of deadly heresies. And it was called pantheism. Ellen White, in commenting, Special Testimony, Series B, number 7, page 37, she says, "The sentiments in Living Temple regarding the personality of God have been received even by men who have had a long experience in the truth. Those whom we thought sound in the faith should have failed to discern the spacious, deadly influence of this science of evil. Should alarm us as nothing else has alarmed us. Those doctrines followed to their logical conclusion sweep away the whole Christian economy. They make of no effect the truth of heavenly origin, rob the people of God of their past experiences, giving them instead a false science." Folk, John Harvey Kellogg had diverged so far from the path of truth that John Harvey Kellogg's thoughts in the Living Temple did away with the Adventist message. Ellen White said it would sweep away the whole Christian economy. In the book Living Temple, again from Special Testimonies, still Series B, number 2, pages 50 to 53, Ellen White said in the book Living Temple, there's presented the alpha of deadly heresies. The omega will follow and will be received by those who are not willing to heed the warning that God has given. Living Temple contains the alpha of these theories. I knew that the omega would follow in a little while, and I trembled for our people. Now, folks, just a side point away from Kellogg for a moment. Pantheism was the alpha of deadly heresies. And Ellen White said that at the close of time, there would come another heresy called the omega. Now, in the alpha, in John Harvey Kellogg's book and in his teachings on pantheism, the alpha of apostasy said that everything in the plan of salvation, everything is in man. God is in you. He's in the trees. He's in the flowers. He's in everything. But just as Alpha is the beginning of the Greek alphabet, and Omega is the end. There's a similarity. They're both part of the Greek alphabet, but one is at the beginning, and the other letter is at the end. Folk, Alpha said everything is done in you. In the Omega of apostasy that we are facing today, the omega of apostasy says everything is done outside of you. Jesus did it all 2,000 years ago. Just accept that idea. Nothing has to happen inside you. There is no human response to what God has done through Christ. And that's what the Omega, in a nutshell, says today. Just believe what Jesus did 2,000 years ago. Kellogg, after Ellen White came out with these statements, you can imagine what John Harvey did. He wasn't used to people telling him he was wrong. John Harvey Kellogg retorted that Ellen White was not inspired to write such criticisms of his book. Kellogg claimed that she had gotten faulty information from Weeping Willie, her son. Willie White was called Weeping Willie because Willie would become very sad when he would see what people were doing with the Adventist message and with his mother's writings. So Kellogg claimed Ellen White was not inspired to write those things about my book. She got all that information from her son or from General Conference President A.G. Daniels. Kellogg claimed to believe, this is incredible, folks, he claimed to believe in the inspiration of Ellen White, but was not willing to heed a word that she said. Commencing with this subtle assault on Ellen White, Kellogg proceeded to go after the youth in the church. Folk, now here again, it's that two tracks on the railroad. Two tracks. They're so close together, and we've got to be so willing to say, Lord, save me from myself. Because, folk, John Harvey Kellogg, at the time when he is turning away from the Lord, He was saying, I believe in Ellen White. I think she was inspired. But those things that she is saying that I don't like, well, those aren't inspired. She got those from somebody else. Folk, be very, very careful what you do with the writings of Ellen White. Don't go down the road where you come across something that you disagree with that doesn't go along with some pet idea that you have. Don't get on that track where you say, well, that wasn't inspired. She didn't write that. That was something that Uriah Smith put in, or that's something Leroy Froome came up with. She just didn't know, but she didn't write that. Folk, be very, very careful what you do with the spirit of prophecy. Folk, I have heard people for decades, and I'll tell you just one story. A lady had been an Adventist for 50 years. Had some meetings out in a state where she was. She invited me there, she and her husband. Had meetings. Q&A came along. The issue was, is the church Babylon? I said, no, the church is not Babylon. And to back that up, we have the book Testimonies to Ministers, pages 25 to 50. Her response was, Ellen White did not write that. That was added in by Uriah Smith. Folk, I told the lady, I wrote to her, and I said, you know what? You have started on a slippery slope, and I will not go down that path with you. Folk, if you hear anybody on any subject where Ellen White says something very clear and the person says, oh, but no, that's not true because so-and-so says this and she didn't say it anyway. Folk, you go down that path, I promise you, we will end up exactly where John Harvey Kellogg's going to end up. And all the time this is going on, let's get the backdrop. Battle Creek College had been moved to Berrien Springs. The work was being carried on there in a strong way. Kellogg, in spite of the counsels that had been given through the years, warning against gathering large numbers of people at Battle Creek, made plans to reopen Battle Creek College, which would be operated by the Battle Creek Sanitarium. Invitations were sent to our young people throughout the country to come to Battle Creek for their education, but conditions from a spiritual standpoint, from the standpoint of misleading theological views, had not changed. Kellogg and his close associates were leading an insurrection. And in December of 1905, there was printed Series B, number 6, Testimonies to the Church, regarding our youth going to Battle Creek to obtain an education. And this is what Ellen White said. Special Testimony, Series B, number 6, page 56. At the sanitarium in Battle Creek, the students and helpers have been encouraged by the managers to write to their parents and friends and to tell of wonderful things being done in the institution. Things that Ellen White had revealed to her as being far from wonderful. Folk, Kellogg has rejected the spirit of prophecy. He is adroitly leading people to pick and choose from the spirit of prophecy. But he then says, God is doing wonderful things in Battle Creek. Folk, let me tell you something. Wonderful things, maybe a synonym we might use today would be, oh, those are miraculous things. Those are miracles. Folk, the greatest miracle of all is a simple submission to the authority of God in our life. That is the greatest miracle. For John Harvey Kellogg to tell the young people to write about the wonderful things being done in Battle Creek, hogwash, hogwash. God was not in Battle Creek. John Harvey Kellogg was in Battle Creek. Kellogg sought to steal control of the Battle Creek Sanitarium away from the denomination, but miracles would confirm that God was still leading. Really? Really? Kellogg would misappropriate funds. He was stealing, folks. He was stealing money for selfish purposes and cripple other denominational work. But miracles would still confirm God's leading? Now here's that fine line again. Here's those two tracks again. The only safe track that assures that God is leading is a humble submission to His authority in our lives. That is the assurance of heaven's leading. It's not about miracles, folk. I mean, come on, Revelation 13 says that the lamb-like beast will be able to cause fire to come down from heaven on earth in the sight of men. Is that a miracle? Have you ever seen that before? Folk, does that mean that the lamb-like beast is now doing God's will? No. No. Kellogg would write the book Living Temple that would do away with basic Christianity and specifically Adventism, but miracles would confirm God's still leading. Kellogg would oppose and destroy the influence of the spirit of prophecy, but miracles would confirm God was still leading. Miracles confirm nothing. The greatest miracle of all is the submission to the revealed will of God. Shipwrecked. Shipwrecked. Jones, Canwright, Wagoner, Kellogg, all lost their way because of a very simple principle. John Harvey Kellogg became too big for his own britches. You know, my dad used to say that. When we'd get a little bit haughty and a little bit uppity, my dad would all, and it's funny how you remember little things that your parents say. But he would look at us and he'd say, you know what, son? He'd say, you're getting just a little bit too big for your britches. But we knew right then and there what Dad meant. He meant, you better settle it down. You better get your wits about you. Because if you don't, I'm going to get off my belt. Folk, John Kellogg became too big for his britches. He came to believe that the work of God could not go on without him. Scary, scary thing. God doesn't need any of us. He doesn't need me. He doesn't need you. But he graciously offers us the privilege to be a part of his work. John Harvey Kellogg came to think that he was central to the success of God's work. How pathetic! How very, very sad. And all the time that he believed that, he believed that God was leading him. Scary. He was the center of the alpha of deadly heresies. The Omega is here, folk, in our midst. It's all about us. It's all around us. The desire to exalt ourselves and to call it the working of God. Will we become so self-deceived as John Harvey Kellogg to believe that we are key to the advancement of God's work? Galatians 6, verse 3 in closing says, "For if a man think himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceiveth himself." Very thankful this morning that God lets us know when we're getting too big for our britches. I just pray that we're listening. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we just pray this morning, because of Jesus' sacrifice in our behalf, we just pray that the Holy Spirit that Jesus promised in John 14, that you would pour that Spirit upon us that has been manifest through the writings of Ellen White. Give us a humble heart to only accept the great and grand and noble principles laid out in those books that magnify your word. Give us that heart of humility to only receive those great messages. And Father, save us from ever flipping and trying to alter what you have said in the spirit of prophecy. Save us from ourselves from doing that. In Jesus' name, amen.